Hey, listen, why don't we do this? Let's get into God's word. Amen. I believe God put something on my heart yesterday. Oh, speaking of, before we do, I wanted to give you an announcement because it was during this that God did that. I don't personally oftentimes tell people to go to do something, to go see a movie. And the reason is movies are subjective. One person might think they're the best movie in the world, and the next person might think they're absolutely awful. And I've recommended movies on more than one occasion and have people just say, like, that was awful. But I just wanted to share with you, there's a movie out in the movie theaters called Let Hope Rise. And it's about a church around the world called Hillsong. You may not have heard of them. You may have heard of them. 50 million churches globally sing their songs every week. And we sang a couple of their songs tonight. It's a story about how God uses ordinary people to achieve extraordinary things. And I'll just tell you this. It was a weird experience when we went and saw the movie. Because I remember when I went and saw The Passion of the Christ, I brought a rag because everybody was like, y'all, you got to bring a napkin because you're going to just experience what Jesus did on your behalf for sin. And I remember crying through that. And I remember I heard about people, you know, when they saw the movie Let Hope Rise in the movie theaters, about just people just being inspired to know who Jesus is in a deeper level. And when we went, my wife and I, we were kind of like, you know, I'm not sure if I really want to go to the movie to see about another church. I want to go to see a movie about, like, cowboys shooting other people and, you know, romantic movies, whatever, like a documentary. I'm just not real into that stuff. But we went anyways. And I just tell you, I've never experienced in a movie theater what I felt during that movie. And that was just the presence of God. The pleasure of God on his people. And listen, sometimes we get wrapped up in church and we think, you know, the people up here, the people that we listen or we buy their CDs or that we sing their music or have it all together. But the truth of the matter is that they're just like you. They're just like me. They're just ordinary people trying to figure out their way through life on their journey to meet Jesus Christ. And they're trying to do the best they can to bring as many people with them. And when we saw that, my wife and I, we got out of the movie and we were just like, man, what did you think of that? And she was just like, I don't even know what to say. It was just awesome. And so I just want to encourage you. You know, it's rare when something faith-based does really good in the movies. And it's even more rare when it gets positive reviews. So I want to encourage you, if you have the time, to husbands, take your wife out on a date. Go treat her to, you know, a really fine steak dinner at Farmer Boy's or something like that. And then go across the street in Redlands to Harkins and support the faith-based initiative to see, because I'll tell you what, beyond seeing a movie about another church, there's an inspiration there for you and for me, and that is that God takes ordinary people and does extraordinary things when they get a hold of Jesus Christ. And I believe that's God's will for your life, and that's God's will for my life. And so I just want to encourage you to go see the movie Let Hope Rise in movie theaters right now about Hillsong. And so I was in that movie last night that I just believe God spoke to me some things, dropped something on my heart. And I just wanted to share tonight what God dropped on my heart for my life. And so let's do that. Let's get into the Word of God. Let's pray today. Father, we just invite your presence into this place. We invite your Holy Spirit to speak to us, to lead us, to guide us out of your words. Lord, I pray that it's not about me. It's not about my words. It's not about my thoughts. God, I pray that it's all about you. Lord, it's all about Jesus, and everything that we do and everything we speak about points to Jesus Christ tonight. Lord, for your encouragement, for your direction. Lord, we open up our hearts to hear. Lord, I ask that you open our eyes to see, Lord, the clarity of your word. Lord, we just ask that you would speak to us tonight. Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name, we all together said,
amen.
Amen. Tonight I wanted to talk to you about a balanced life, living a balanced life. And I'm not talking about dietary balance. I'm not talking about eating healthy. I want to talk to you tonight about living a life of balance. If you've got your Bibles, go to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. And as you're turning to Luke chapter 10, I'll just ask you a rhetorical question that you already know the answer to. Have you ever heard the phrase, it's difficult to see the forest through the trees? You know, the phrase has a lot to say about the life of humanity. Why? Because oftentimes it's the details, it's the minutia, it's the things that happen on a recurring basis. It's the little things that obscure our view of the bigger picture. And I think oftentimes when we look at statements like that, to neglect or to miss the forest through the trees, it's a picture of our lives in the sense that we can have a tendency to get so wrapped up in the day-to-day details of life. I mean, in America, we talk about it like this. It's the grind. You get up, you go to the grind, you do your thing. Your life is full of all sorts of different activities, all sorts of different things, all sorts of different commitments, all sorts of different pastimes, whatever it might be. And we're constantly on this process of going, 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 that we come come home, we go to bed, we wake up again the next day, go, 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 go. Come home, go to bed, wake up the next day, go, 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 go. And we miss out on the bigger picture because we're so focused in on the little details of life. I mean, I think about it like as my kids grow older and as I'm introduced to things like sports and I'm introduced to extracurricular activities and things like that, I look and I'm an observer. I'm naturally introverted. I was having a conversation today with somebody and they were like, Pastor Luke, I know you on the pulpit and I know you outside of the pulpit. And he's like, and he was just saying like, it's amazing to see the difference. Why? Because it seems like I have a lot to say up here, but then when it's just me and somebody else, I don't like to talk. I don't like to open up. I'm kind of a secluded person. I'm awkward. I don't know what to say. And, you know, I'm an observer. I'm a person that likes to sit back and just watch and just calculate and observe and just come to different conclusions. I guess you could say I just judge everybody else. Whatever. One thing I've noticed and one thing I've seen with people in my life, with friends and family members, with people that I've spoken to within the church that have sat in my office or maybe just over a cup of coffee had the conversations with, it's amazing to see how we allow so many things in our life to pull our focus and our eyes away from what really matters in life. You know, I look at a lot of relationships and dealing with young adults for the season of time that I was with a young adults pastor here at the church. Dealing with young adults, it was amazing to see how a lot of kids growing up missed out on having a parent for the sake of having a coach. And their parents were more interested in extracurricular activities and getting them involved and teaching them how to throw a ball or how to catch something or how to teach them how to develop a skill than they were just to invest in the importance of their lives. Or husbands and wives missing each other on a day-to-day basis because one husband's going here and one wife's going here and you're doing this and they're doing that and you're taking the kids here and your job's doing this. And all of a sudden we just find ourselves so wrapped up and so busy and so caught up in everything that's happening in life, and it just happens. We didn't plan it for that. We didn't wake up one day and just say, I want to have more things on my plate today than I have time to do. I want to wake up today and feel stressed out. I want to wake up today and not talk to my wife. I want to wake up today at 6 o'clock in the morning and I don't want to come home until 10 o'clock at night. Nobody plans for that. But have you ever noticed it just happens? It's like gravity, humanity, we're drawn to it. We just find ourselves in the position of allowing ourselves to be caught up in the day-to-day things, the minutiae of life, whatever it might be. It just takes our time and our attention away from the bigger picture in life. You know what happens? It's not just in life that it happens, it's in our faith. It's in our belief. It's in our system of what we call church or what we call Christianity. Is, you know, we get into this place and we get into this time. Okay, you know what? I came. I've got limited time, so the pastor better preach short. When he goes over, man, I tune out. You know, 25 minutes is all I got time to listen to. And I just want you to tell me, what do I need to do? What do I need to not do? Just tell me what to do. Tell me what not to do. Well, I come and, okay, you shouldn't do this. And I know I should love my neighbor. Why? Because the pastor told me Jesus says I should. And that's all. As long as I just know what I should do and what I shouldn't do, I got other things in my life that I want to do. And we get wrapped up in the rules, the performances, the regulations. We get wrapped up in the busyness of life. And as you know, and you know it just as much as I do, because I'm right there with everybody else, you know that it's not always the healthiest thing to do, to be wrapped up in so many things that we miss the bigger picture. And there's a story that Luke accounts for, and I had you turn to Luke, the 10th chapter. There's a story that Luke accounts for in the Bible, that there's a story of two sisters, and it's really a contrast of two people. And it's an image, I believe, of humanity, of us, and our tendency to go one way, and the wisdom to make the decision to go another direction. And so I have you turn there to Luke in the 10th chapter, and we're going to read a story about the opportunity that two women, two sisters had to host Jesus. Now think about it for a moment. What would it be like to host Jesus Christ? Right? I mean, here's the guy that's going around healing all who are sick and oppressed of the devil. I mean, signs, wonders, and miracles are following this guy. Whatever he says, I mean, he's speaking things that people have never heard. I mean, they marveled at him because they said, man, who is this guy that he knows the things that the religious people know, but he teaches them in a way that the religious people have never taught before. And Jesus says, Mary, Martha, Lazarus, I'm coming to your house tonight. I don't know about you. There's probably 50-50, maybe 60-40. There are the OCD clean freaks. Any clean freaks in the house? I can't relate to you. I'm sorry. I don't know you. How many of y'all are like, my house, maybe you could personify it like this. Excuse the mess. We're living here. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Where you at? Where are my fellow? Amen. Praise Jesus for grace and mercy. And perhaps Mary and Martha were the kind of people that say, excuse our mess. We're living here. And so Jesus is saying, hey, I'm coming to your house for dinner. And I could just imagine the announcement, the preceding Jesus. And Mary and Martha have that moment of like, oh my gosh, Jesus is coming to our house. Like, quick, swipe the dirt of the dirt floor under the rug so that he doesn't see our mess. They get to clean it and then Jesus shows up. And here we find the story of what went down with Jesus coming to dinner at these two women's house. And I believe it paints a picture of our lives. And this is verse number 38 in the 10th chapter of Luke. It says, it happened that when they went, the disciples and the apostles that way went, he, Jesus, entered a certain village, Bethany's where they lived, and a certain woman named Martha came. He welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me. Now, I'm going to stop there for a minute because I love it. That's like classic sibling rivalry. I've got a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old at home, and it's like every 30 seconds, it's like, Mom! He did her. Dad, tell Bjorn, Emma, my son's name is Bjorn, my daughter's name is Emma. Tell Bjorn to share. Dad, Emma's not doing that. Emma won't share. Dad, she's not helping. It's like, I don't care. And yet, here they are, adults. Jesus is in their house, and it's like, Dad's there again. And Martha comes to Jesus, and she's like, Jesus, my sister is a sloth. She's lazy. She's neglecting the responsibilities and the duty of a hostess. I'm trying to make you a dinner. I'm trying to put it on. And when everything's set, and don't you care? Sob story, right? That she left me alone to do this all by myself. I'm trying to serve you, Jesus. And sometimes that sounds like us. You think about it for a moment. It's like, God, don't you care that I go to church and yet this is going on in my life? God, don't you care that I believe in Jesus and the pastor was telling me that God wants a better life for me and my relationship's falling apart? God, don't you care that everything's happening that's contrary to my life and there are people out there that are doing nothing about it? Don't you care? You see, we can get so wrapped up in the mundane. We can get so wrapped up in the day-to-day. We can get so wrapped up in spending our time on doing things that are, listen to this, not important to God. Keep in mind here for a moment that Martha was spending her time while Jesus was in her house cooking for Jesus. Now that's good. That's expected of a host to provide hospitality. But this is also the guy, the very same guy that took bread and broke it and fed 5,000 men out of a couple of loaves of bread. This is the same guy that took a couple of fish, blessed them, multiplied them, and 5,000 men, and not including women and children, ate. I mean, she was spending her time cooking dinner for a man who did not need her to cook dinner. And she was upset doing that. So often we get wrapped up in doing the things in life. I mean, think about it for a moment. The things in life that are not important to the grand scheme of things. We get so wrapped up in spending our time watching the favorite TV show instead of with our kids. We get so wrapped up in spending our time coming and going because of the different activities. We get so wrapped up in time working the extra hours to gain a few extra dollars so that when we die, we leave with nothing on earth anyways. We get so wrapped up in the minuscule and in the minute details that in life in general, we miss the bigger picture. And here's a story. Now, I think Martha is a representation of a lot of Christians. Why? Because, you know, we get wrapped up doing things for God. I'm serving. I'm going to church. I'm hearing the pastor preach. We were talking today about people. It's like they find Jesus and they'll come to every church service. They'll go to every event that's going on. They'll go to every Christian concert. They'll listen to every podcast. They'll do everything they can to just hear, or to do. But then nothing's changing in their lives. And they end up finding themselves like Martha, complaining, God, I'm doing all of this for you, but yet you're not doing anything for me. Tell somebody to bless me. God, tell somebody to come my way and build me up. I'm building you. Tell somebody to build me. And we find ourselves in this position, but look what Jesus says in his reply. This is fascinating to me. It's so contrary. Verse number 41, it says, Jesus answered to her, he said, Martha, Martha. Man, whenever Jesus says something twice, he's trying to get your attention. Like when he says, verily, verily, I say to you, it's like, listen, listen, right? Hey, hey, like that, right? Okay, so it's like, Martha, Martha. I'm almost thinking like this as I'm doing this real time. I'm thinking Martha's like over here working, right? And Jesus is like, Martha. She's just working, yeah. Martha, like breaking her attention. Listen. Martha, listen to what I have to say. And he says it. Martha, you're worried and you're troubled about many things. If that's not a statement that Jesus spoke to a lady a couple thousand years ago that applies to you and that applies to me, I don't know what else in the Bible is. Because that's exactly it right there. You're worried, you're concerned, you're anxious, you're busy about a whole bunch of things in life. But one thing, not two things, not three crafty points, Jesus says, one thing is needed. And Mary has chosen that good part, which will not be taken away from her. Jesus basically answers to Martha, 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 you're worried about a bunch of stuff that's not important. Mary chose what is important. And I'm not going to tell Mary to get up from what is important to help you do what is not important. And so often what happens to us is we get caught up. It just happens. Nobody planned to be as busy as we are. My wife and I, we were chuckling about it, and I'm just as guilty as everybody, but we drove by a bus stop the other day. Now, if there's something that says time, open time, it's waiting at a bus stop. Why? Because you are literally waiting for something to come at you, right? And so we drove by this bus stop, and there's probably about six or seven people at the bus stop, and every person at that bus stop was standing around looking at something. And I'm not trying to be on my soapbox about phones and about the conditions that doctors are talking about. Your neck's going to start hurting at the end of your age because you're not designed to look down. I'm not talking about that. But you see, even in the times when we have time, we've created a life and a culture that we've made ourselves so busy that we don't even have time in the times that we have time. And we're wrapped up with, I mean, come on, think about it. We're wrapped up with people taking pictures with duck lips of themselves. We're wrapped up in what everybody else is doing. And now there's a psychological thing that they're actually saying is a real problem. That not just millennials. They like to say, oh, it's the young people dealing with them. Sorry, it's not just the young people. It's called FOMO. Anybody heard of FOMO? Fear of missing out. I don't got time to do anything in life because I'm afraid I'm going to miss out on what's, are you kidding me? What somebody else is doing. We have created for ourselves more things to do than there are time in the day. And you know, even when it comes to our Christianity and with our walk with God, we have created for ourselves more things to do than God even asked us to do. Jesus said, Martha, there's one thing that's important. Which, if there's anything I want you to understand about life, what you do for Jesus Christ is not as important. I'll say it the other way because I wrote it differently. What you do with Jesus is far more important than what you do for Jesus. But you see, in our faith, we have a tendency like gravity. Just tell me what to do. Pastor told me on Sunday night, you know, I was just talking about it on Sunday night. One thing to do. Find an opportunity every day to serve somebody unexpectedly in the name of Jesus. Anybody been doing that? Man, I've been doing it. It's been fun. It's been surprising. All right, some of you. Well, so Pastor Luke, just tell me what to do. Okay, love the Lord with all your God, with all your heart, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor like that. Okay, good. That's all I need to know. Thank you. And we get so wrapped in doing something for Jesus that we miss out on the importance of doing something with Him. And what you do with Jesus is far more important than what you'll do in your life for Jesus. As a matter of fact, there's a story in the Bible. I was reading my kids the book of John last night, and I think it's in John the 6th chapter. There's a story of the people are following Jesus, and He performs all these signs, wonders, and miracles, and they said, Jesus, we want to do what You do. And Jesus says, you don't need to do all that. All you need to do is just follow Me. He broke it down so simply that it's not about all the great things that'll come because of Me. All you need to do is focus on being with Me. And what we do with Jesus in our lives is far more important than what we do for Jesus in life. And so what happens is we end up living our lives empty. Why? Because we're continually pouring ourselves out. We're continually serving. We're continually giving. We're continually going. I'm serving my kids. I'm serving my boss. I'm serving my friends. I'm trying to do what religion told me that I should do. And we're continually serving and serving and pouring ourselves out. And we find ourselves coming with a place that we are on empty in life. And then we wonder, God, why am I so unhappy right now? And Jesus is saying to you, to me, to His church, church, you're worried about a whole bunch of things that are not important. And what is important is that you spend time with Me, because what you do with Me so far outweighs what you do for Me. I'm a fan of business and management. I graduated from Cal Baptist with a management degree. And one of my heroes in business management is a man by the name of Peter Drucker. Peter Drucker literally came in and just revolutionized marketing in the 70s and in the 80s. The father of modern marketing. And he coined this phrase a long time ago. And we say it and we understand this in the business world. But we miss it in the church realm. As he says, in businesses, it's not so much about doing things right as much as it is about doing the right things. You see, in church we think, am I doing it right? Am I loving right? Was I nice enough? Was I kind enough? Did I give enough? When I dropped the money in the offering, was it enough for God to be happy with me? And we worried about doing everything right. And Jesus says, don't even worry about doing things right. That comes through a process of knowing Me. He says, what is important is doing the right thing. And the right thing is spending time with Me. And I felt like God just dropped it in my heart. I was telling you yesterday as it was in the movie, God just said to me, Luke, as you're seeking for what you want to do for My kingdom, I felt like God just said, if you just spend time with Me, I will pour into you what you want to do. And in my own life, I'll just share with you, because you know, I'll just share with you a common misnomer, okay? A common misnomer is this, that the life of a pastor, all right, let me just tell you what y'all think it is. The life of a pastor, everybody thinks, is golf, coffee appointments, and in-depth study. I remember when I started preaching, my daddy told me, he said, you know what? Preaching's great because it's going to make you read your Bible more than you read it before. And I say to him, a whole hearty amen, it does. But the truth of the matter is that that's not, I wish, that'd be awesome if that's actually what pastoring is all about. But when it comes to pastoring people, when it comes to interacting with people, when it comes to pouring out or sowing into the people's lives, just to be there in a time of crisis, just to hold somebody's hand, just to talk somebody through something, just to smile at somebody, just to tell somebody, hey, you know what, you can do it today. On top of that, just trying to plan the day-to-day services to try to make sure that the music team, we all work together hard. Elijah and his team are working hard just to try to make sure that the songs sound good and that the air conditioning's on. All the different things. There are more things to be done within a church than there are time and people to do them. And I found in my own life, I was laughing with my assistant Madeline. We were kind of laughing about it. The weeks and the days leading up to the services that I am going to spend my time up here talking are always, without fail, the busiest days. It's like, she texts me every morning. She says, okay, Pastor, here's your schedule. And it's like, today, your schedule is, you got to preach tonight, okay? You got a 9 o'clock, you got a 10 o'clock, you got an 11 o'clock. So-and-so wanted to talk to you, you have a lunch appointment. After that, there's a meeting about this, and we wanted to come. And then you say, okay, I got a couple of hours to think about what God wants me to say. And somebody knocks on your door, even though there's a big do not disturb on your door. Like, I got to get with Jesus sign on my door. They say, can I talk to you? Sure, why not? And there's just never enough time in the days that God wants me to speak to you to get with God. It just happens. And until we come to the conclusion as followers of Jesus Christ that it's not about doing things right, but it's about doing the right things, until we come to the conclusion and the understanding that what I do with Jesus far outweighs what I do for Jesus, we're always going to set ourselves up for disappointment and failure in life. And that's what Jesus is saying to Martha right here. It's Martha, Martha, you're living your life wrong. Can I just tell you, you're not doing it right. Why? Because Jesus says this in John the 15th chapter. When he gives the analogy of Jesus being the vine, he says, I'm the root, I'm the vine, you're the branches, you're just a part of me. He says, I'm the vine, you're the branches. He says, you abide in me, I in you, and you in me. I love that. He who abides in me and I in him, and I abides in me and I in him, bears much fruit. Look what he says. For without me, you can do nothing. And that's not just for without me, you can do nothing in church. That's not just for without me, you can do nothing as a Christian. For without me in life, you can achieve nothing. You might achieve the success and the accolades of the world, but you'll still die disconnected from God. And so the most important thing is not what you do. Jesus says, if you abide, that word abide means to live, to stay, to dwell. If you do exactly what Mary did, to just sit at my feet and receive from me, you will receive the nutrients that come from the source. And you'll do great things. Jesus says, greater things than I do, you'll do. Why? Because you're in me. Because you have my spirit now within you. A couple of weeks ago, I was meeting with our creative team. I came from that. I'm one of those weird artsy people that I believe that through art, through design, through all sorts of different mediums that God expresses, that we can express what God has placed on the inside of us that we can't verbally communicate. And I was meeting with all of our creatives, our lighting designer and our sound engineers, our video programmers and our video directors. I was meeting with Elijah, our worship director, and Michael, our web designer, and Antonio, our creative communications guy, and our graphic designers. And I said, guys, I believe that what you're doing in the church is so important because you are expressing through your gifts and through your talents what God has given to you that cannot be communicated within words. But if you do not take time to have just Jesus time, you will never reach the pinnacle of what God created you to do, and you will always find yourself scratching the bottom of the barrel. I myself, working in the video department for decades, found that to be true. That the times I needed God most to come through on an opener for a conference, I'm sitting there waiting, and it wasn't until I crawl under my desk and say, Holy Spirit, I need you because the conference is tomorrow and I got a blank screen and Pastor Deborah is knocking on my door. That the time with Jesus would redeem so much more. I could sit there and work, or I can get a little bit of time with God. And my productivity would skyrocket. Because what you do with Jesus in your life is so much more important than what you do for Jesus in life. And Jesus tells us, without me, you can't do anything. Listen, Martha's problem was not that she had too much work. Your problem is not that you have too much on your plate. You say, Pastor Luke, that is my problem. Maybe it is. You got yourself into that. Martha's problem is that she allowed her work to become a distraction and to pull her apart. To the point where she was complaining and she was griping about her service to Jesus. And there are far too many people who call themselves followers of Jesus that are walking around on with their tanks on empty, looking like my dad used to say, sucking on lemons in life. Because they're overworked and they're tired and they're bitter about their job in the kingdom. And I heard somebody say it like this: few things in life are worse for the Christian faith than to try to serve Jesus without communing with Jesus. That leads to burnout, that leads to washout, that leads to being tired, that leads to bitterness, that leads to anger, that leads to frustration within the kingdom of God, just like Martha. And Jesus says, I just simply want you to spend some time with me. I simply want you to take a moment out of your day, to take a moment out of your schedule, to take some time and sit at my feet and receive what I want you to know. Whenever we start to criticize others and complain about our service, it's time to examine our lives. Whenever you start to say, well, so-and-so over here, and so-and-so over there, and I'm working, and I'm volunteering 3 services a week, and but they're only doing 1, and I see that they're doing more than me, or I see that they're more talented than me, it's time for us to take a moment and examine our lives. To say, what is it really the issue in my life? Is it really that somebody's outshining me? Is it really that somebody's not working as hard as me? Or is it that I'm tired and I'm frustrated and I'm empty and I feel burnt out and I feel wasted and I feel left out because I'm over here and they're getting all the good stuff and the fruits of my labor? Then maybe the problem's not that somebody else is getting the fruits of your labor. Maybe the problem is that you're not seeing the forest through the trees of your life. And simply put, when it comes to what Jesus had to say, we have to take a place in our lives where we have to examine. It's why it's so important for us to look at everything we're doing. How are you spending your day? How are you spending your time? What are you doing to build your relationship with that spouse or with that friendship or in your business or whatever it might be with your children? To examine what is going on in your life. Why? Because it will just take over if you don't. And so today I just thought I'd just share with you that what we do for Jesus is so much more important, or what we do with Jesus is so much more important than what we do for Jesus, that maybe as a church, maybe as people, we need to organize and examine our lives and examine the place in which we sit and which we stand with Jesus, and we need to bring a balance to our life. A balance. What is a balance? A balance to our life. A balance of your serving with your sitting. Did you guys, I hope you saw my updated notes because that's secondary. We need to learn to balance fulfilling the Great Commission with being filled by the Great Commissioner. That's what I was hoping y'all would catch your emails on. It's all good. You and I, as followers of Jesus Christ, need to learn and examine in our lives to balance fulfilling the Great Commission that Jesus said, go and do something, with being filled by the Great Commissioner. Because Jesus' own words are, without me, you'll do nothing. And far too many people are spending their time trying to fulfill what Jesus did by not being filled by Jesus who did it. And so we need to bring balance to our lives, to balance to the serving of our lives, the serving of your spouse, the serving of your children, the serving of your job, the serving of your entertainment, the serving of your stomach, whatever it might be, to bring the balance of your serving by adding sitting to your life, sitting at the feet of Jesus Christ. to bring balance to sitting at the feet of Jesus Christ. You see, the most important part of your life is the part that only God can see. It's the part that only God can see. You see, we're so wrapped up in legacy as humans. I want people to remember me. I want to live, and I want to have a purpose, and I want to have a reason for existence. But the most important thing in your life is the part that only God can see, and that's the connection and the relationship that you have with Him in those intimate moments of your life. Because guess what? That's what eternity is based on. But you see, somewhere along the line, we got wrapped up on eternities based on how good I am, how many times I attend church, how Christianese I can speak, how high I can raise my hands, how loud I can sing, how often I can say, love you, brother, or I'm praying for you, or send somebody emoji of praying hands. When the most important aspect of your life is not how many emoji of praying hands you can send, but what you're doing with Jesus while you're here on earth. Because that is a mindset that says, God, this short amount of time that I live, I'll spend it with you so that I could spend it with you in eternity. And in doing so, in being filled by the Great Commissioner, we will fulfill the Great Commission. Why? Not because somebody told us to love your neighbor. Why? Because the pastor said I should. No, I'll love my neighbor like John says in 1 John. I'll love my neighbor because God's love so overflows in my heart that I can't contain it any longer. Because I've got so much Jesus on the inside of me that it just keeps coming out. And people keep telling me, you're a little bit funky now. Amen. I got the funk of Jesus Christ on the inside of me. And I can't stop it because I keep sitting at His feet. And God put on my heart, Luke, if you'll just seek me, I will pour into you. I won't dribble into you. I won't just give you a little bit. If you'll just get into me, I will get into you unlike you have ever seen or imagined. And I just said to myself, that's too good for me to keep it to myself. Church, if you'll just get a little bit into Jesus, Jesus will get a lot of bit into you. But we have got to set priorities in life. And what our problem is our priorities are all messed up. Our priorities, because our culture leads us to this conclusion, our priorities are me. Myself, secondly, and I, number three. But you see, your priorities need to be in alignment with what God wants. Jesus Christ is always first. Amen. As hard enough as it sounds, above your kids, above your job, above your wife, above your hobbies, guys, above your car. Others, secondly. And yourself third. You see, without alignment of priorities, we focus on ourselves, we focus on Jesus, and then whatever's left over, we focus on others. But Jesus said these words, and I'll just put it up on the screen. Jesus said in John the 10th chapter, verse number 10, He says, the thief doesn't come into your life except to steal from you, kill you, and destroy you. But Jesus said, I have come that you would have life and that you would have life abundantly. I believe abundance, according to the definition of the heart of God, is not a life full of things. I believe an abundance is a life full of Him. That's what an abundant life is a life full of Him. But see, we get so wrapped up trying to get a life full of things that we miss out on an abundant life full of Him. And if you'll just take some time in your life to bring balance to your life, it's going to come and result in hard decisions. Sometimes those decisions mean saying no to something. To saying, not right now. Listen, sometimes those decisions mean leaving something that you started unfinished right now. As hard as that might be. Growing up, my parents taught us this by just saying no. You know, we wanted to do sports. We wanted to do all these extracurricular activities. My parents said, great, as long as it didn't interfere with Jesus. Guess what? It just so happened that sports are on Sunday and practices are on Wednesday. And it's just like, well, I want to do this. Well, if it interferes with Jesus time, no. And growing up as a teenager, I didn't like that much. Didn't like my parents much for that. But I'm so grateful now growing up that I had parents that understood that it's more important my time with God than what I do in my life with my time. And so it might mean that you need to make hard decisions in your life. Martha had to make the decision to let go of a perfect dinner. Let go of a perfect relationship with that person and invest in a perfect relationship with Jesus Christ and watch that relationship with that person begin to flourish because of your relationship with Jesus Christ. And you know, the interesting thing is that it's a balance of sitting and serving. Because does this mean that making priorities in my life to set time with Jesus Christ gets me off the hook to serve Jesus? No. Because the beautiful thing about Mary and Martha's story is that Martha is listed once again having dinner with Jesus Christ in John the 12th chapter. Jesus just raised her brother from the dead. So guess what? She's cooking a turkey. I mean, she's having a big dinner. Her brother was dead for 4 days. It's like celebrate good times. Come on, right? And in John the 12th chapter, it talks about it. It says, now they're in the Passover. Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus, who had been raised from the dead, whom he had raised from the dead. Verse number 2. There they made him suffer. Look what it says. Martha served. But you know the cool thing about John 12th chapter, verse number 1, versus Luke, the 10th chapter, verses number 42? Nowhere does it say Martha complained. You see, I believe that this was the time now. Martha learned her lesson. Hey, you know what? I got a duty to fulfill. I'm going to host you, Jesus. I'm not going to come in here and ignore my responsibilities as a host. But I'm not going to get wrapped up on the unimportant things. I'm going to serve you, but then I'm going to sit at your feet. And I'm going to sit at your feet, and when it's time, I'll serve you. And I'm going to balance my life with being filled by the Great Commissioner with fulfilling the Great Commission. And I'm going to add sitting time to my serving time. And I'm going to evaluate what am I doing with my life so that I don't get wrapped up in the day-to-day and then I miss the big picture of life. And I'm going to do something for or with Jesus so that I can do something for Jesus. See, church, God will be exalted with or without you. Said it on Sunday, it's a hard thing for us to grab a hold of. It's something that God's been just hammering my life with. Luke, I do not exist for you. It's what God speaks to me. You exist for me. You know, we like to paint this picture of he's our daddy and he loves us and he wants to do everything for you. And Jesus painted that picture. But at the same time, understand that in our world, children outlive their parents. It doesn't work that way with God. He is the everlasting Father, beginning to end. He outlives us, outdwells us, which means we exist for Him, not He for us. Which means to you and I, God will be glorified in this earth, whether we like it or not, whether we try or not. Psalms, the 46th chapter, a verse I believe that all Christians should know and practice, says it like this. Be still, in verse number 10, and know that I am God. Be still. Take a minute, sit at my feet, and just know I'm God. Because I'll be exalted in the earth. I'll be exalted among the nations. God says, listen, whether you like it or not, with or without you, I'm exalted because I'm God. But I believe our purpose here on earth is to make His position a little bit easier to do so by spending time at the feet of Jesus Christ so that we could not walk around this world empty, but we can continually pour ourselves out to the people of this earth for the love of Jesus Christ, while on the inside of us we are being filled with a fountain of everlasting water, a continual springing source that only comes by sitting at the feet of Jesus Christ, which means that you and I on a daily basis, need to spend time at the feet of Jesus Christ. And I'll just finish with this thought. So many occasions in my office, I've sat with people going through major crises in their life, and when I ask the question, what's your devotional life like? It's like one after the next. The same thing. It's like predictable, right? I've been there. I'm there too sometimes. We hang our head low. Well, Pastor, I know I should read my Bible more, and I know I need to pray more. Which is a translation to me, Pastor, I don't read my Bible, and I pray for my food. And then we wonder why our life is a mess. When Jesus said, Martha, Martha, you're worried, you're wrapped up in a bunch of things that don't matter. Your sister Mary chose the one thing that does, to spend time with me. Church, every day of your life, every day you exist, every day you wake up and breathe in and breathe out until the day you die, what you do with Jesus will so far outweigh what you do for Jesus. And let me tell you something. If you want to do something for Jesus, the best way to do something for Jesus is to spend a lot of time with Jesus. Because if you get a little bit of Jesus in you, He'll get a lot of bit of Him into you. Take some time this week to look at your life. If you're complaining about feeling overworked, overused, stepped on, trampled on, somebody else is making it faster than you, that's an indication, a prognosis, that you need to take some time and look at what you're doing with your time. And I guarantee you the solution is going to be sit at Jesus' feet every day. Start somewhere, guys. Get on YouVersion and read the Bible every day. If you don't want to read the Bible, Pastor Luke, I don't read so good. You would talk like that if you don't read so good. You can listen to it. Just push play and the Bible will read to you. Just spend some time letting some guy like James Earl Jones read to you. Darth Vader is on the Bible reading to you. Spend some time at the feet of Jesus getting His Word into you. And I tell you what, when you sow into God, when you seek after God, the promise is He will come and meet you where you're at. Tonight, there are those of you in this place, and I'm going to let you out in just a minute. There are those of you in this place tonight. Listen, you've been wrapped up. It seems like life has just got you by the neck. Beat up, discouraged, disappointed. Things are not going your direction. You're empty on the inside. Maybe you're burnt out, washed out by what church has been done or what you've had the picture of religion. Let me just be the one to tell you tonight, that is not God's image and that is God's, not God's picture for you. You see, God sent Jesus Christ to die on a cross for you and for me. And today, I want to give you quickly a moment, just like we talked about tonight, to examine your life, to examine your heart, and ask you, where do you stand with God? Where is your place with God? If you were to leave tonight and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case, but listen, we're all one accident, we're all one incident, we're all one epidemic away from our eternal destiny. And the question is, what would happen to you if you were to die? Would you find yourself in the presence of God, or would you find yourself absent from the presence of God in hell? See, the Bible is very clear that there's only two options. You don't get a second try. You don't get to come back and redo it again if you didn't do it right. You get one chance here on earth in this life. And so often we spend our time spinning our wheels, doing all these things in life that are unimportant to the grand scheme of things. We try to live a good life, try to help other people, try to think good thoughts, try to attend church on a regular basis, try to live our life and tell as many people as we can that we're a Christian, try to wear as much religious jewelry that we can. But God says, these are all the things that you're anxious and you're worried about. That's not the thing that matters. God says like this, I want you to sit at my feet and get a hold of me. How does that happen? That doesn't happen because you just come to church. It doesn't happen because your parents told you were a Christian. That doesn't happen because you think some good thoughts or because everything's good and you're trying to stand for social justice. That happens because you've given, surrendered your heart, your life to Jesus Christ. See, in John the 3rd chapter, Jesus says to a religious man, Nicodemus, He says, listen, in order to inherit, to be a part of the family, to be brought from the outside to the inside, to inherit eternal life, He says, you must be born again. Born again from the beginning of God's Word to the end of God's Word has always meant the same thing in the heart and in the eyes of God. Here is what it means. It means that you've given all of your heart, you've given all of your life to Jesus Christ. It's not about what you do for Jesus, it's what you do with Jesus. And so many people are trying to spend their life doing something for the name of Jesus when God says, first and foremost, I want you to do something with me, and that's to live your life with me. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to His church, and He says, listen, I know you. I know what you're doing. I know all the things that you're working on. I know all the things that you're spending your time on. He says, I'm going to return. And when I return, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. I'd rather find that you're up. I'd rather find that you're down. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, stuck in the middle somewhere. He says, I will vomit you, reject you, eject you from my mouth. He says, it's a metaphorical statement that Jesus is saying, you're not going to make it on the pretenses that everything you're doing on the outside, working on and spending your time on insignificant things in life, are going to make it good with me. Jesus says these words to His church, come back to me. He says, you think you're doing everything good? You think you're clothed with all the right clothes? He says, you don't realize how naked and destitute you are in life. And He says, oh, I wish you would come to me. And in that same statement, He says these words. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, whoever's going to open the door, he says, I'll come in and I'll dine, I'll be, we'll spend time together. I'll be with them and they'll be with me. Like John said, you abide with me and I abide, live, stay, and dwell with you. We are connected in a relationship. Jesus says, if you open up the door of your heart and accept me in and invite me in, I will come and I will abide in your life. You can sit at my feet and receive that which is important in life. Listen, many of you are carrying holes, wounds, and scars of life, the emptiness and the void of what am I here for? Why do I exist? You exist to bring glory to God. And life happens when you start to live the purpose of your existence for Jesus Christ. He came to give you life, not just eternally, but life of fulfillment, of purpose, of destiny here on earth. Genesis, the Bible tells us that God created you in His image to bring glory to Him. It's time for you to stop living life wrapped up in the mundane and the minutiae of everything and waking up and going to bed and waking up and going to bed and hoping that you can scratch by a living at the end of this world and maybe somebody will remember you. But now it's time to have an eternal existence with God by inviting Jesus Christ to come into your heart and to come into your life. And I want to give you that opportunity right here, right now. Jesus says that if you confess Him before men, He'll confess you before His Father. He says if you deny Him, He'll deny you. I want to give you the opportunity right now to accept the gift of God, eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go like this. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. Smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I do, if that's you, I'm just going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. See, what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, you know what, Pastor Luke, that's me today. I feel like maybe I've been trying to do things the wrong way, and I haven't been spending enough time sitting at the feet of Jesus. And today, I just want to make that commitment to do so. Maybe you're saying, you know what, I've never given my heart. I've never given my life today, but I feel like God's knocking on my heart right now, and I want to respond. Maybe you're saying, you know what, I feel like maybe I've just been playing church. I've been kind of going through the motions. I know to speak all the right things, and I know what to say, and I know what to do, but I feel like there's still this emptiness and this void on the inside of me. Listen, that's the Spirit of God saying, hey, listen, you're not there yet, but come on, come to Jesus, and let's work this out together. It comes by sitting at the feet of Jesus, doing what's important in life, and that's getting connected to Jesus Christ, the author of life. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now, it's a divine appointment wherever you're at. From the front row to the back row, side to side, even if you're watching around the campus, calling the closed circuit TV, at home, watching on the live stream, we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together in just a moment. And what you're doing by the raising of your hand is saying, I want you to include me in that prayer. And we're going to pray together today. I won't embarrass you. I'm not here to do that. I'm here to build you up. But it comes today by making the decision to follow Jesus. Will you respond to the Spirit of God knocking on your heart today? Your choice, your call. I'm going to count to three wherever you're at in this place, front row to back row, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. If the Spirit of God's knocking on your heart, will you respond to the invitation of Jesus Christ in your life right now to choose life in Jesus? It's your choice, and I believe you're going to make that right choice. Today, I'm going to count to three, and that's your time to respond to Jesus. I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge you, put it right back down, and we'll pray that prayer of salvation together right after this. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. I see you right there, sister. I see you back over there. I see you guys over there. I see both of you guys over there. Anybody else in this place today? I see that hand over there in the back. All right, I see you. Say, man, I wonder if I should. All right. Say, man, I wonder if that's me. The Spirit of God's speaking to you in this place today. Come on. It's your turn. It's your time to respond to Jesus Christ. Anybody else in this place today? Several hands have gone up. Here, let's do this. I said we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. Let's all stand to our feet if you're in this place today. If you say, you know what, that's me, I raise my hand, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ, I'm going to pray with you right here, right now. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come and meet me up here at this altar today. Get into the aisle and come meet me right here. Let's pray together, you and I. Let's change destinies wherever you're at. If that's you in this place, you want to give your heart, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, come on, come and meet me right here. Let's change destinies right now. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, you come and meet me right here, right now, wherever you're at. If the Spirit of God is knocking on your heart, listen. Let's not play church. Let's not mess around, all right? Your life is too valuable. You need to understand that God cares more about you than you care about you. So much so that He sent Jesus to die on a cross for you. And you're feeling it right now. I'm connected. I feel you right now. The angst on the inside of you is the uncertainty. That's the invitation of the Holy Spirit in your life right now to make a decision to change. Listen, they came. I'm not embarrassing them. We're going to pray together, and I'm going to give you one more opportunity. My friend Elijah is going to sing a song. And if that's you in this place today and you're feeling that invitation, listen, listen. Be wise enough to respond to God Himself inviting you to be a part of His family today. Change your life with Jesus Christ. Respond to that invitation. If that's you in this place, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come meet me just like them up here at the altar. Let's change destinies tonight. Go for it, my friend.
I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hands.
If that's you, come on.
Yes, you breathe. Feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep.
Hey, cool. I'm not the Messiah. I'm not the Savior. I'm a man. But I told you about it. I pray that that seed is sown. And here's what we're going to do. You know what? Just to cover you guys, because I love you too much, we're just going to pray together, okay? But I want you guys to know something. You guys got to know this. Jesus tells a story. It's an amazing story. He talks about the shepherd. He says, man, if a shepherd has 100 sheep and he loses one, what does he do? He says he leaves 100 good ones to go find the lost one and carry him back. The Bible tells us, he says, and Jesus says in that statement, he says, man, doesn't all of heaven rejoice over just one person who Jesus carries back? And you guys felt that invitation of Jesus. You got to know something, that heaven is rejoicing for you right now. I mean, that's mega, that's heavy. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray a prayer together. I know I went late, which means y'all didn't listen, but it's okay. We're going to pray a prayer together. Would you just join with me together? Let's all bow our heads, close our eyes. If you're out there and you know you should have done this, this is your opportunity. Join with me. God doesn't listen to the prayers of your words or the words of your mouth. He listens to the prayers of your heart. It's not an abracadabra formula that we're going to say that makes everything right. It's your heart reaching out to God, saying, God, come into my life. And that's what we're going to do today. So I'm going to ask everybody in the place today to repeat these words after me. Let's pray together. You guys, especially up front, okay? You're going to give your heart to Jesus. So let's all just bow our heads, close our eyes, and just repeat these words after me. Father God, I come to you today, and I acknowledge that I need you. Today I make a commitment to leave my past behind. I ask that you forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me of all the decisions that I've made. I invite you to come into my heart, to come into my life, and be the Lord, the Savior, the leader of my life. I give my life, I dedicate my life to Jesus Christ. Fill me today with your Holy Spirit. I'm a Christian, headed for heaven, leaving hell behind. My past is gone, my future is with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Congratulations, sister. Hey, great job. Hey, guys, really quickly, here's what I want to do. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. We don't want you guys to leave empty-handed. We want to hook you up with some stuff, okay? Some information, help point you in the right direction. If you need somebody to pray with you, we want to connect you with somebody that will pray with you, invite you to come back to church and hang out, get some word of God, and you get strong in the ways of God. So you guys just turn to your left, my right. Go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Thank you, Lord.